based at the University of Louisville. Let's go ahead.
All right, thank you. Thank you very much. When I first thought about putting together this presentation for the summer school here, I thought maybe I should do something about quantum-resistant multivariate cryptography via interpretive dance. I thought that would be reasonable, but unfortunately I have a back injury, which you won't get the pleasure of watching me dance, but you may hear me occasionally yell out in pain. So if you hear any screams, it's either me in pain or one of you in pain from the presentation. And so anyway, let's get started. I have a few goals for the presentation. I want to talk about some fundamental concepts that are relevant to multivariate cryptography. So it's fundamental, like areas of work, some of the components of analysis. I want to go through some of the history, some of the simple history of multivariate public key cryptography, and then try to get into some notion of security arguments that we can feasibly derive for multivariate systems. Okay, so the basic idea of multivariate public key cryptography is we're going to use as our foundation nonlinear systems of equations. And so all of this has to do with trying to create trapdoor one-way functions. And the trapdoor is built into a system of nonlinear equations in some particular way. So we need to be able to find a preimage of some element in the range of a system of nonlinear equations and use that fact to construct our schemes. So the fundamental problem of solving systems of nonlinear equations is very difficult. It's been studied for a very long time. And so we can have some confidence that there exists some problems here that are pretty difficult to solve. An interesting note, a lot of times in advertisements for this as a discipline, we want to compare it to lattices. We want to compare it to maybe elliptic curve cryptography. We want to compare it to RSA. And so we say, with elliptic curve cryptography, that's based on 19th century mathematics, right? This is the pitch. It's 19th century mathematics, really. So that can't be that sophisticated, right? Because it's 19th century. With multivariate public key cryptography, this is really something that lies inside of algebraic geometry. That's the appropriate discipline for analyzing this. So that's 20th century math, right? That's 20th century mathematics, so it must be more sophisticated. All right, so when we study the multivariate public key crypto systems, we can allow ourselves to be restricted to simply analyzing quadratic systems of equations, quadratic formulae. There are a couple reasons why, in general, we would want to do this. One is key size. So, for example, if you have a system of m quadratic equations in n unknowns, you can count the number of monomials and then see exactly what the public key size will be if you publish these. And so in general, the public key size is cubic, roughly, in the number of equations variables. So if you went up to cubic equations, for example, that power would increase more, and so the scaling of parameters would be much worse. Okay. Also, why should we expect it sufficient to have quadratic equations? Well, the underlying problem that must be difficult for us to have a chance of having any secure multivariate quadratic system is the MQ problem. Okay, so the question of actually solving directly the system of equations. And the problem of solving quadratic equations over a field is an NP-complete problem. And so it is at least possible that we can come up with difficult instances of this problem. Okay, so this is what a scheme looks like. This is what a public key scheme looks like. You have to publish a few values for everybody to be able to compute with. You need to compute what your polynomial ring is, what its structure is, and then publish actually what your quadratic polynomials are. Okay, so how do we actually construct a trapdoor in this? Typically what is done is we use the butterfly construction. So we start out with a quadratic map, which is eventually is efficiently invertible in some sense. That is, you can find pre-images fairly easily, and then you hide that structure by composing affine maps T and U on either side of it. Okay, and whenever we compose those, then you're changing basis for the plaintext space, changing basis for the ciphertext space, and hopefully that hides the actual structure of the equations. Okay, but one thing to note is that since P, here the public key P, is just a representation of F, it's not, in particular, an arbitrary instance of MQ. Okay, so there's no way that we can actually really base our security for these schemes on the MQ problem. Okay, that's not feasible. So what can we base them on? Well, we can base them on other complexity theoretic assumptions, possibly, if we can get those proofs to work. Or we can base it on difficulty for some other problems. So here are several problems that are related to multivariate public key cryptography. So there are certain special complexity theoretic problems that are of importance. So one would be isomorphism of polynomials, which we'll talk about in a little bit. And there's been a great deal of work of trying to get complexity theoretic proofs of security for multivariate schemes directly off of those problems. But we don't have a lot of success on that. There's a giant spider over there. Also, very closely related to this, actually, is another field that seems kind of far afield, group isomorphism problems. So there's a connection between group isomorphism problems and some of these complexity theoretic problems that we're going to discuss in a little bit. And that's kind of interesting because there's also been a lot of work in this area that's completely independent of the development and the history of MPKC. Grobner basis algorithms, okay, so there's a discipline. If we have very effective Grobner basis algorithms, then it gives us an idea about parameter selection and that sort of thing for schemes. Min rank analysis, okay, so this is more of a very specific topic on very structured schemes. But the idea about this is you take your public key and you try to come up with linear combinations of your public equations that have low rank. Okay, so rank analysis is important. And then differential analysis. This is another method of analyzing schemes. So in this list, the last two here with the stars on them, they really only come into play if you have very special structured private keys. So if you're deriving your systems from very particular structured quadratic functions. The others are really more general. They apply in whatever context, okay, just as long as you have an MPKC. So let's look at some of these complexity theoretic problems. So the simplest and most basic level complexity theoretic problem that relates to multivariate cryptography is the morphism of polynomials problems, the MP problem. Okay, so the MP problem, you specify a field, and you specify two particular functions, f and p. Okay, and then the question is, can you computationally recover some maps t and u that show that these are isomorphic, that shows that p is actually a representation of f? Okay, so that is the MP problem. Show that there is a morphism between these two polynomials. So actually, it is a morphism. It's not an isomorphism, as I just said. It's just a morphism problem. So the U and the T, they could be singular. Okay, so it's entirely possible that a reasonable solution to this would include the possibility of T and U being singular. As a particular case, in some sense, of this problem, we have the isomorphism of polynomials problem. So the isomorphism of polynomials problem is directly showing an isomorphism between two polynomials, f and p, showing that p is legitimately just exactly a representation of f and nothing more. And a third problem in this area is the IP1S problem, the IP1 secret problem. And so for this problem, it's basically an instance of the IP problem, but you require that T is the identity map. So in this equation right here, you require that T is just the identity. So you really just have one secret as part of your private key, the U. Okay, so from the description of these, okay, there's the interpretive dance. The spider is doing the dance. Intuitively, you would think, okay, these problems are just nested in one another, so that if I have a solution to one on the list, then I can solve the ones below it. Okay, and that's basically true, but it's not actually so trivial and obvious as it might seem at first. So let's compare, for example, the top two problems here, morphism of polynomials and the IP problem. Suppose I have an instance of the IP problem. So I have a map F and a map P, and I want to find these T and U, which are invertible, they're bijections, to satisfy this equation. If I have an oracle which will solve the MP problem, it's entirely possible if I have some degenerate pair P and F, it's entirely possible that my oracle will reply with a T and U, which are not bijections. Okay, so it's not obvious that the oracle for the MP problem will help me solve the IP problem. You can do some work to make it actually help you solve it efficiently. Similarly, with the IP problem and the IP1S problem, if I have an instance of an IP1S problem and I call an oracle for the IP problem, it may give me a solution in which T is not the identity. Okay, so it's not obvious that it should be more difficult as a problem. Okay, so how does this fit in with cryptanalysis, at least classical cryptanalysis? So we have different types of attack, and they each kind of live in their own framework. So the algebraic attack is just directly trying to solve the MQ problem. Okay, direct solution of the MQ problem. On the other hand, at the other end of the spectrum, we have structural attacks. The structural attacks are where you utilize the actual structure of the core map and try to use its fundamental properties to get a key recovery, to develop a key recovery attack. In between these, and this has received some attention, but maybe not quite as much, is an alternative algebraic attack. This is where you try to solve one of these particular complexity theoretic problems that I gave you before. You try to solve those directly. Okay, if I have a general technique of solving those, that will help me to potentially break schemes. I'm sorry, I'm a little distracted by the spider. I'm not afraid of spiders, I love spiders. I'm just trying to see what kind it is. It's very large, I like it. Outside of my house last year, I had a spider that was about this big, just beautiful, gorgeous. I took pictures of it every day, you know, being out there. All right, where was I? What was I saying? This happens a lot. Okay, I'm on slide 8. That's good. That's good. I'm making progress. Okay, the complexity of these particular alternative algebraic attacks, so these complexity theoretic problems. The MP problem, the morphism of polynomials problem, is NP hard. There is a reduction from the three-tensor rank problem showing that this is no easier than the three-tensor rank problem. So IP1S, this is an interesting result. IP1S is graph isomorphism hard, and in a particular way. You can parameterize in a particular way to see how it relates to graph isomorphism. And that's very, very interesting because graph isomorphism is one of these few problems that lie in a very interesting area in terms of complexity theory. You know, like so factoring and classical complexity theory and graph isomorphism seem to lie in this sort of nether region. Where it may be difficult and maybe it's not. So that's a pretty interesting problem. Although something that should be mentioned about that result about the IP1S is graph isomorphism hard, it requires cubic polynomials in there. So it doesn't necessarily directly relate to quadratic instances. There's an interesting paper about this also. So anyway, deciding IP, the decision problem for IP, is not NP hard unless the polytime hierarchy collapses. And you may very well believe that the polytime hierarchy does collapse. So for example, if you think it's the same as P space or something. But I think the result is something to the effect it collapses down to the second level or something. Something which people typically would not believe. Okay, so this is the second item on that list of five different sub-disciplines. This is the group isomorphism problems. This is pretty interesting. There was a paper in 2012 in AMS, which computationally solved a certain class of group isomorphism problems by figuring out how to find generators for an isometry group of Hermitian bilinear forms, Hermitian maps. And so if we have a particular bilinear function B, we can look at its isometry group. Okay, and specifically what that is that's the set of all general linear functions on V, so that when you apply them to the two inputs, you don't affect the output. Okay, and you can see how this might be related to cryptography. This is almost like it's almost like a kernel and transporter problem. You're trying to find, if you wanted to count equivalent keys, you could look at this problem and it would give you, if you had a solution to the transporter problem, it would allow you to count how many possible keys you have. If you have a count of the number of distinct different ways of mapping from one polynomial to another, and then you have all of these different ways of equivalences of mapping in the same way, then it allows you to count equivalent keys. So that's a pretty interesting paper in itself. And it's very closely related to this particular paper. This also came out in 2012, both of these in 2012. These are nice names here. It's worth reading whatever they write. Polynomial time algorithms for quadratic isomorphism of polynomials, the regular case. And now, when I saw it in 2012, I don't remember the regular case being there. And in particular, there was a problem. There was a serious error in proposition 9 of that paper, which was about simultaneous normal forms. And so I haven't actually taken a look at this. I just noticed that it was updated earlier this year. And I'm wondering if maybe my memory's just not good for this, but I think I'm wondering if the regular case is taking care of that issue. But in any case, it's definitely worth looking at. So another of the five areas would be looking at algebraic solving techniques for MQ, for the general MQ problem. And we have several algorithms for this, which have decent effectiveness. We have F4, F5 algorithms from Fogier. We have the XL algorithm family, including mutant XL. And each of these have slightly different performance in some way. But the key component in understanding the complexity for all of these is degree of regularity analysis, which that's pretty fun, but I'm not going to talk about it. But yeah, if you understand the degree of regularity for a particular scheme, then you understand basically how hard it is to actually try to directly invert the system of equations with Grobner basis techniques. Okay, so down to the structural attacks. What types of structural attacks do we know about? So there are rank attacks, and there are essentially three kinds of rank attacks, and depending on the context, those three kinds may actually be two kinds. So we have the low rank attack. This is where you find quadratic forms in the span of the public polynomials, which have low rank. And essentially what you're doing is you're finding maps in the span of the public key, which only contain formulas that have very few variables involved. I'll give an example of that when I get into the history portion of the talk. Okay, so another possibility is a high rank attack. And so a high rank attack is doing something that's somewhat different. You're trying to find a quadratic form in the span of the public forms which has somehow a conspicuous high rank. So if it's full rank, it doesn't necessarily tell you anything. If it's almost full rank but not quite, then it may tell you something. Essentially what it's telling you is that you've found a polynomial which tries to avoid some particular set of monomials. It may not necessarily avoid certain variables. It may just be the case that it's avoiding certain monomials, but it gives you some information about what's going on the private key, possibly. Then there's the dual rank attack. This is maybe normally what's applied more than high rank. The dual rank attack is where you're specifically finding a small subspace, which is in the kernel of a large subspace of the span of the public key polynomials. So what you're trying to do here is you're trying to find variables which just don't occur in very many of the formulas in the private key. If a variable like x1 or something only occurs in 3 out of 36 equations, then this attack would reveal that. You'd be able to find that. So the dual rank attack is a special case of a high rank attack, actually. Okay, so another type of structural attack that you can have is the discrete differential attack. And and the discrete differential attack, we use this object, the discrete differential of a field map. So if I have a map F from a field K to K, then if I take the differential, essentially what it is I take a difference equation, that's these first two components, and I normalize it by subtracting off the difference equation evaluated at zero. Okay, so it's just normalizing a difference equation. And this operator, D, the operator has a lot of a lot of nice properties. It is a linear operator. It acts linearly on the function space. If F is a quadratic map, then DF is a bilinear map. And so this is the important case for us. If F is quadratic, then if I consider the case where I have affine maps, so I'm emphasizing that here by drawing out the plus constant. If I have affine maps, it's no different than having linear maps as far as the differential is concerned. Okay, and here's a particular example. So this polynomial here, f of x equals x to the q to the theta plus 1. This is the differential of the C star crypto system, which we'll talk about soon. And if I directly compute df of ax, I will get this quantity. It actually has to do with the fact that this is in characteristic 2, this scheme. So I hid that information, but you'll get out this quantity. And so you can see this is symmetric in the variables a and x, and that's always going to be true. In this particular case, it's also in characteristic 2, so it's also anti-symmetric. If you notice that a and x are the same thing, you'll get 0 out of there. And these all are useful properties that we can use to break schemes. Okay, so here's a particular example of computing a differential. So if I have an equation over GF2, and here I have three variables, and here's my quadratic equation. If I compute the differential, notice what happens. Okay, so here I'm in characteristic 2, so these terms here are actually linear, right? The x1 squared and x2 squared. Those are actually linear. That's the same as x1, x2 if I'm over GF2, right? So like I said before, the differential just kills anything that's affine. It gets rid of it. So those terms just don't contribute anything at all to the differential. The 1 doesn't contribute anything. The x2 squared, the x1 squared contribute nothing. But these terms in which we have cross terms, right? We have two different variables, x1 and x3 and x2 and x3. They do contribute terms and two terms each. So it's with A playing the role of the first variable and A playing the role of the second variable. We get two terms out of each one of those. Okay, so that's how you actually can compute it effectively. And here is how we can express it as a bilinear form. Okay, so if I take the vector A and express it as A1, A2, A3 and the vector X, X1, X2, X3, then to get exactly this quantity, I can just stuff this matrix in the middle. Okay, so what this allows us to do is it allows us to convert problems that are about quadratic functions into problems that we can use linear algebra techniques for. Okay, because we're expressing these quantities as matrices. Okay, so differential attacks come in a couple of different flavors. One flavor is a differential symmetric attack. And for the attack using differential symmetries, essentially you're trying to solve a differential equation to find a linear function that will reveal some structure of the hidden map, reveal some algebraic property of the hidden map. For differential invariant attack, What you're trying to do is detect a linear action on a subspace by your public key. That would be a very weird property in general, right? If you have a system of quadratic equations, for a single quadratic equation, you would expect in general for it to act linearly on a subspace of dimension roughly square root the dimension of the plain text space. As soon as you have two such maps, you would expect for them to simultaneously act on linearly on a subspace of dimension zero, okay, just by intersecting subspaces. So you do not expect for a system of quadratic equations to have any subspace on which it acts linearly. So it's a very strange behavior if you have that, and differential invariant attacks pick up that behavior. Okay, so more detail with the differential symmetric attacks. If I have a differential symmetric attack, it's actually taking advantage of this particular relation, which is a general linear differential symmetry. And why we can say general is because if we have other types of linear symmetries on quadratic maps, we can reduce it to this type of linear symmetry. And so the task of a differential symmetric attack would be to try to discover this map L here that can somehow, when you symmetrically apply it to the two inputs, we can factor it out. Okay, and that's the point of a differential symmetric attack. Okay, these attacks have been successful. They were used to break S-flash, which is a C-star minus scheme, the original Matsumoto Amai scheme, and some of these other schemes. And I will describe these in a minute. Okay, so this is high-level stuff right now. In principle, for whatever quadratic function we have, we should be able to find and solve for the space of linear maps L. We should be able to effectively solve for the space of linear maps L, at least if we know the private key. If we know the public key, then that should be hidden. Okay, so differential invariants, like I mentioned, it's you have a linear action on a particular subspace. So what you need to do is look at the span of the differential coordinate forms. So take each polynomial in your public key and take the differential. You can get that matrix out. Now that matrix, it will act linearly on everything, on the entire space. But if you find that all of your matrices act on a particular subspace in the same way, that they send it to the same place, then you're detecting a linear action on the entire quadratic function on that space. So that's how we can actually find them. So what is a first-order differential invariant? A first-order differential invariant is a subspace V, which has the property that there exists a subspace W of dimension no greater, so that simultaneously all of those matrices that we found, the span of those matrices for all of the public equations, for any map in that span, if we map V with it, we end up inside of W. So simultaneously, all of the differential coordinate maps are mapping a subspace V into another subspace W. Okay, that's a first-order differential invariant. And this has been used to attack schemes. If not nominally, then in effect the same thing. The Kipnis and Shamir attack on oil and vinegar does exactly this. It's exploiting this exact property. And you can break other schemes as well. Different types of schemes that don't have mixing of different types of monomials or specifically specify different types of monomials in the private key in weird ways. So how do we analyze these in general? What we do is we use projections onto these spaces, V and W. And if you do that, then you get this symmetric relation. Okay, so this is a symmetric relation, but it's nonlinear. So these two maps, MW perp and MV, those two maps are acting on a differential. So this M is in the span of the differentials. And out of that, you get zero. But if you think of the coefficients of MW perp and MV as your variables, this is a quadratic equation. Okay, so it's not a linear symmetry, it's a quadratic symmetry. Okay, and again, for this, the situation is the same as for differential symmetries. In principle, we should be able to, if we have access to a private key, we should be able to determine the maps MV satisfying this relation, this nonlinear differential symmetry. Okay, so how does this all fit into history? Let's go through a bunch of examples, finally. Finally, examples of different schemes and then attacks on the scheme. So this is the history portion. So one family that was developed a great deal years and years ago is the triangular schemes. So the idea behind triangular schemes is to derive maps which you can invert using only linear solvers. That's the basic idea. Later on, that got generalized. You can invert with solving a small quadratic. But the basic idea that as it began was just like this. So imagine this system of equations for some collection of i's here, some finite collection. So the first y1 is x1. The for yi for all I greater than 1 is xi plus some quadratic polynomial in all the previous x's. Okay, so if you think about what the differentials will look like in this case, maybe I can draw it. If you think about what the differentials will look like in this case, the differential of the first example, y1, that'll be just 0. It'll be a giant 0 matrix. For the y2, actually, it'll also be a giant 0 matrix, if we're in characteristic 2 anyway. If we're an odd characteristic, then maybe you can have a non-zero entry up here in the corner, but everything else is zero. If you look at y3, what is the differential of the map y3 going to look like? If you compute it explicitly, you'll get some non-zero terms in the upper corner, but everything else is zero. So you get these little squares of non-zero terms that get bigger and bigger and bigger. So the public key, your polynomials aren't exactly these, they're linear combinations of these. And so the differentials are going to be linear combinations of these matrices. Okay, and so there are going to exist, in particular, linear combinations which have very low rank. So the point is rank attack. We can do rank attack on this, and it's just inherent to the methodology. We can do rank attack on it and recover some equations which only involve a few variables. That's low rank attack. But in fact, actually every rank attack works on this particular scheme that I presented there, the low rank attack, and then the dual rank attack, which is a high rank attack. So we can actually use whatever rank method we want for attacking that particular triangular scheme. So when this scheme first came out, an attack like this came out, and so then they tweaked the scheme and changed it a little bit. And there were so many and still continue to be new proposals involving triangular systems where maybe you take two triangular systems and you try to paste them together in such a way that you keep consistent rank, but there's always a technique for ripping them back apart and ultimately doing a rank attack to destroy them. And so triangular schemes were murdered by rank attacks. They just fundamentally can't work. They just can't work. Okay, so that it has no more lineage worth looking at for the most part. So the balanced oil and vinegar scheme, so this is interesting. This is very interesting. The balanced oil and vinegar scheme works like this. We have a quadratic map in two O variables, and we have O equations. And the equations have the property that if you set the last O variables to constants, they're linear in the first O variables. So just setting the last O variables to constants, you can solve for the first O variables. Okay, and that's how you can invert effectively this particular polynomial F. Okay, so how do you get a public key system out of that? You don't actually get any benefit out of composing a map on the front for mixing the polynomials. But you do get a benefit from mixing the variables. Mixing them up makes it not obvious what subspace of the span of the variables is acted upon linearly by this system. Okay, so in order to invert for your public key, what do you do? Well, you invert F, first of all. You arbitrarily set the last O variables to constants. You're able to solve for the first O variables. And then you invert the linear map L in order to get back the plain text. Okay, so it's just sequential inversion. So here's an example of this scheme, a very small example. I'm using GF7 here. Okay, so up here in the list of monomials that we have, and I wasn't trying to be fancy and just have the constants go off the end. That's entirely by accident. Up here, if you look at X1 and X2, they only occur linearly anywhere. Okay, so they occur in some quadratic terms, but in those quadratic terms, they only occur linearly. There are no quadratic terms in X1, X2, just that set. Okay, so on the subspace generated by X1 and X2, this quadratic function f actually acts linearly. If I look at the other variables, X3 and X4, I do have quadratic terms in just those variables. Okay, but on the other hand, if I just plug in values for those variables, so here I've plugged in the value, let's see, what were my variables, X3 and X4, I plugged in 2 for X3 and 3 for X4, and then I simplified all these expressions. Now look, everything up on top is linear in X1 and X2. Okay, so I can collect all of my coefficients together. Okay, and now I have something that's entirely just an affine map in X1 and X2, and so it's very easy to invert. Okay, so this is the core map. This would be the private part of the private key. And how do you develop the public key from this particular core map? You would, just instead of calling your variables x, call them u, where u has this relationship to x. Here's the affine transformation between the two. And then your public key is derived just by doing a substitution for u for these values. And so for this particular example, this is what the public key would look like. Okay, these are coefficients of monomials. This is x1 squared, x1, x2, x1, x3, x1, x4, x2 squared, and so on. So this particular scheme was broken, as have many, many, many schemes in multivariate cryptography. And the way it was broken is by a differential invariant attack. Okay, as we mentioned before, the fundamental property of the core map is that it acts linearly on a particular subspace. Differential attacks are designed specifically to utilize that fact to find that subspace. So if we let O represent the subspace generated by the first O coordinates of the core map, so the first O coordinates of the core map, then look at the differential. You see that since we don't have any quadratic terms involving just variables inside of O, you'll have just a zero in the differential there. There are no cross terms in there because there are no quadratic terms. But we'll have non-zero terms in all the other three quadrants of this matrix. So this has the particular property that if I were to imagine multiplying this matrix by a vector over here, if I multiply it by something that only has non-zero components in the O space, so non-zero on top and zero on the bottom, I get mapped to just to a vector having zeros on the top and non-zero on the bottom. So I actually map O to its orthogonal complement. Okay, mapping O to its orthogonal complement. So if I have an invertible map, right, if I have any map M1 that's invertible inside of the span of the DFI, then it must then map the orthogonal complement of O back into O. So if I compose two such maps, okay, the inverse of one and another one, M2 first maps O into the orthogonal complement of O, M1 inverse then maps the orthogonal complement of O back into O, so this particular matrix right here must have an O invariant subspace. Okay, O is an invariant subspace. And you can see that by looking at what form such a matrix would have to have. It would actually have to have this form with the zeros down here in the lower quadrant. So now with this matrix, if I multiply by something in the O space, so non-zeros on the top component and zeros in the bottom component of the vector, you can see that in the product, the only part of this matrix that affects the answer is the A. And so in particular, the answer will have non-zeros in the first component, okay, and zeros in the bottom. Okay, so we can find invariants. We can find invariant subspaces of maps very easily. So once you find that invariant subspace, what do? You find a basis for that invariant subspace, extend to a basis of the entire system, and now you have a change of basis transformation So you can transfer the public key into a new basis in which it has the same kind of structure as the private key, that it acts obviously linearly on this giant subspace. So then you can use the exact same technique that the legitimate user uses to invert. Okay. Okay, so it's just broken. One way to fix that is to make it unbalanced. Okay, and that is to increase the number of vinegar variables. When you do that, as soon as you increase the number of vinegar variables, you lose this property that the public key acts linearly on a large subspace. If you increase by just a couple of variables, you lose that property. Now, there are still some collision techniques you can use to break the scheme if the number of vinegar variables is only slightly bigger than the number of oil variables. But if you increase dramatically, so if you make the number of vinegar variables twice the number of O variables, then it's hard to find this. It's hard to attack the scheme. Okay. So HFE, this is one that we'll talk about a little later. I thought I had this slide after I described HFE. But anyway, UOV, that's this scheme, it has a really interesting natural parameterization built into it, and that is you can parameterize how far you are away from a completely random system of equations. If I make the vinegar variables almost all of the variables, then it's essentially like a random quadratic. But if I make the number of vinegar variables smaller and smaller, I'm parameterizing towards that balanced case, okay, where I have easy inversion. So it's very interesting that there's this natural parameterization to how close we can be to a problem that we know is hard. Okay, so there are other types of constructions as well. So those two types of constructions, the triangular schemes and the oil vinegar schemes, those are schemes that rely on just a single field, and then we build systems of equations on the top of that field. You can try another approach. You can try some algebraic structure lying over a field and try to build a scheme with that. And the most popular way of doing this are the so-called big field schemes, where you use a field extension. So we can use a particular field extension K of a finite field FQ. Here it's degree N. And then you identify an element inside of the extension field with a vector, n-dimensional vector, over FQ to the N, or over FQ. And so for the C star scheme, this is historically the first of these massively multivariate public key schemes. The way it works is you do the butterfly transformation again. You apply an affine map U to your input X. Okay, that gives you another vector, call it U. We identify it with an element U inside of the extension field. Then using the arithmetic inside of the extension field, we raise it to the power of Q to the theta plus 1, and that gives us a new element inside of the extension field. We identify that with a vector over FQ and apply the other affine transformation T to get the ciphertext Y. Okay, so this is kind of a flow chart of how it works. Algebraically, it's exactly this. Your ciphertext Y is this map applied to the plain text X. Okay, where your, in particular, your core map F is just this exponential map. Okay, so this is actually a really interesting scheme just looking at it in historical perspective, because in some sense this is like a multivariate version of RSA. What we have going on is exponentiation. We just aren't publishing what our exponent is for exponentiating, but we're changing a basis to hide that exponentiation. To decrypt, what you do is exponentiation again. You find the correct exponent so that when you exponentiate, you invert this particular map. Okay, so it's very interesting, the fact that it's very similar to RSA. Okay, so here is an example. We can actually construct one of these core maps F and show its quadratic structure, that it's actually a quadratic map. And so the small example is we let our extension field K be GF2, so that's our FQ, our base field, join some element alpha satisfying this algebraic relation. Okay, so then in the extension field, since this satisfies a degree 3 equation, this is a degree 3 extension of GF2. And so any element I can express in this particular basis, the basis alpha squared alpha 1. Okay, so this is an arbitrary element inside of K. So if I want, I can express it as a vector. Okay, so I can express it as a vector x1, x2, x3. Okay, relative to this basis, we can explicitly write out what left multiplication by x is as a linear operator, and it's exactly this matrix. So how do we read this? In this basis, my third basis element was 1. So if I wanted to multiply this matrix by 1, what would I multiply by? I would be multiplying by the vector 0, 0, 1. Okay, and so if I multiply by 0, 0, 1, what do I get out? Just the last column, which is exactly x. Okay, so that's good. X times 1 is x. If I wanted to multiply x by alpha, up here, if we do it just equationally, we would get an x2 alpha squared, an x3 alpha, and x1 alpha cubed, which is the same as x1 alpha plus x1. Okay, and so if you do that substitution, you get exactly this quantity, x2 alpha squared, x1 plus x3, the quantity alpha plus x1. And so that's exactly what would happen if you multiplied by the vector 0, 1, 0, representing the element alpha inside of this extension field. So we can explicitly get this matrix for multiplication by the abstract element x. On the other hand, in characteristic 2, right, we're in characteristic 2, squaring is just a linear map because it's a Frobenius automorphism. Okay, so being the Frobenius automorphism, we can get the explicit structure of it. If I square the element 1, I get 1, so that's this last column. If I square the element alpha, I get alpha squared, well, that's this column. If I square the element alpha squared, I get alpha squared plus alpha, that column. Okay, so we have the explicit form of squaring. So if I want to get an explicit form for the map x cubed, for example, how can I get x cubed? Well, I can square x and then multiply by x. And that's exactly what we do here. We take x, square it, then multiply by x. And you can see here, obviously, that you're going to get a system of quadratic formulae in x. So that's the connection. We're using a particular representation of the extension field in order to find a representation for our core map F, which is quadratic, system of quadratic polynomials. Okay, so that scheme was broken, as, again, many, many systems have been in multivariate cryptography. And it was broken based off of a trivial differential relation, and that's the fact that over a field of characteristic 2, the differential is anti-symmetric. So if I take df of v and v, I get 0. So in particular, I can let v be an output of the core map f. So if I let it be an output, there's some input that maps to it, so v is equal to u to the q to the theta plus 1 for some u. Now if I explicitly write out what the differential is of that map x to the q to the theta plus 1, I get this quantity. And in this quantity, you can see that we can actually factor out a u to the q to the theta. And when we factor this out, we get that 0 is equal to this quantity. Well, we're in a field, so if we multiply two elements together and get 0, one of them has to be 0. And in fact, it doesn't matter either way whether u to the q to the theta is 0 or this quantity must be 0. Okay, so we get that that quantity there must equal 0, so therefore v u to the q to the 2 theta is equal to v to the q to the theta u, and this is a bilinear relation. It's linear in u, it's linear in v, which if you recall are the input and output of that core map f. So we have quadratic map and bilinear relation on the input and output, and so that means that if we apply the proper affine transformations, we get a bilinear relation in the input and output of the public key. And since it's a public key, we can generate lots of plain text ciphertext pairs, and we can solve for unknown coefficients in this bilinear relation. And ultimately, if you do this long enough, you can restrict the space of possibilities enough that you make the scheme inefficient, or you just break it outright. Okay, so that broke C star. That was from Patarin in 96. And so afterwards, he suggested several different options of how to recover a secure scheme from the same type of idea, this big field idea. So basically, it's a bunch of modifiers in some sense. So one is replace the hidden monomial map with a low-degree quadratic map, HFE. Low degree so that you still have invertibility, but not monomial so that you don't have that C star linearization equation relation. The next possibility is he suggested you can add vinegar variables. You can add vinegar variables just like with oil and vinegar. You can add random equations to the core map to add some randomness to it. You can include a random sum and, which is different. The plus modifier here, adding random equations to the core map, that's increasing the dimension of the core map. The second one is not. It's the same dimension, it's just a new sum and. You can project or fix some of the values of the input coordinates. So project onto a subspace before you ever apply the map. Okay, or you could remove some of the public equations. And this last option was the one that was the most explored the most quickly. And the reason is that relation that we had before on the last slide, this relation down here, if you apply the affine transformations to try to get relations between the input and output, the plain text and ciphertext, you'll see that the matrix T or the affine map T needs to be invertible for that relation to have full rank, for you to be able to use it effectively. And so if you remove public equations, you're making T not full rank, you're making it not invertible, and so it makes the attack harder, okay? Increases the complexity. So let's look at more at that minus modifier. I need to pick up the pace. Let's look more at the minus modifier. If we remove our public equations, a bunch of things can happen. If we remove something that's too small, then the scheme is still insecure. So for example, if I remove just one equation, there's actually an algebraic technique for just recovering that equation back. So it doesn't do anything. If I remove too many equations, then the rank of the scheme is messed up. I can just arbitrarily set values for a lot of the variables and recover a scheme that's easier to solve. And so the scheme becomes too inefficient. I have to make the number of variables way too large for that to work. If you have R just right in some Goldilocks zone, then the theory was that we may have a good signature scheme. Well, that signature scheme was S-flash, which again, as I've mentioned before, it's a multivariate scheme, and so it is broken. Okay, because many, many multivariate schemes are broken. It's not true of all of them, but this scheme is broken also. And so what does the minus modifier do? Very specifically, here's the private key T, U, and F, and F is this particular polynomial. The public key is T pi composed with F composed with U, so the T pi includes a projection onto N minus R coordinates of the output. So you're just removing R public equations, just removing the last R of them. Okay, this scheme was broken with an attack using multiplicative symmetry. Okay, and so this is the multiplicative symmetric relation. If I multiply symmetrically on the inputs of the differential by an element sigma, I can factor out that the effect of that sigma, the action of sigma on there. And factoring that out gives us a really interesting relation between the differential of our map and the differential of the core map. And if you lift this up to the public key, it actually gives you a relationship between the differential of the known public key and the differential of the map altogether. And so you can actually utilize that in order to recover conjugate of multiplication by sigma as a linear map by U inverse. Okay, so if I apply this to my public key, you can see I have a U and a U inverse next to each other, so they cancel. And now I have a multiplication map, multiplication by sigma, which is right next to an exponential map, which is a multiplicative map, right? So I can just factor it straight through that multiplication, and I get another multiplication on the outside. And then I can interpose a T inverse and T, and then recollect into this first component. This is just a linear map, and this is the entire public key. Okay, this is the entire public key of a scheme without the minus modifier. Okay, so what is the result of this? If I can find this in sigma, then rank system, then I can apply Pataran's attack. Okay, and that's exactly what this last little segment here shows. Okay, well, HFE, so there's another direction. C star monomial. and have a big field scheme that way. Why not replace that monomial with a more general polynomial? We can't make it fully general because if we allow any polynomial in the center, then it's an arbitrary system of equations. We have an arbitrary instance of MQ, so we don't have an efficient means of solving it. But if you do something like this, and I apologize for the notation here, some fonts on my computer are corrupted, and so all of my subscripts and stuff are the same size as regular text. This is saying if I just sum up where my monomials have a degree bound, this q to the I plus q to the j, it satisfies some particular degree bound, then I can use maybe Burley-Camp algorithm in order to invert that directly and then compose the affine maps and get a public key. Well, that's HFE. That's exactly what HFE is. This one is also broken. Okay, there's a running theme here. This one's also broken. And it is broken by a very interesting attack that uses rank analysis. It does not use rank analysis elementarily on the input space over the base field. It uses it over actually an n-dimensional representation of the extension field K over K. Actually, I think I have a slide on that. Yes, I do. I do have a slide on that. So it uses Q rank, or at least what I've seen called Q rank a few times, which is an interesting term, but it's nice to distinguish. So consider this particular map. If I have this polynomial F here, I have two quadratic monomials in it, and I'm experimenting with it over a particular finite field K, a degree six extension of FQ. This monomial, if I look at the differential of it over a basis where my column vectors would have the form x, x to the q, x to the q squared, x to the q to the third, x to the q to the fourth, x to the q to the fifth, all the Frobenius multiples of x. And as a row vector over here, a to the q, a to the q to the, a to the q squared, a to the q cubed, and so on, I get exactly this k form, this k linear form. And you can see that this matrix has a very conspicuously small rank. It's got rank just 2. And so that fact was actually used and exploited to affect an attack on this. There are a lot of other technical details over it, though. It actually ended up using Grobner bases and coming up with a system of equations derived from this differential and solving that system of equations directly in order to get the attack. It was very interesting, result. So maybe this is a good time for a break because this is the last portion of the talk. So why don't we take a 10-minute break and come back at maybe 5 minutes till the hour. Brief announcement beforehand. Sad news. Roger the spider committed suicide. He's over here on the floor. So yes, salute to him. Exactly, salute to him. So security proofs. How can we have this in multivariate cryptography? This is one area where multivariate cryptography is particularly deficient. Multivariate cryptography does a pretty good job of finding parameter sizes that seem reasonable for instances of problems, under the assumption that you can't have a structural attack, like a key recovery attack. But on the other hand, for security proofs, it's quite difficult. There are some isolated examples of schemes, but they're, for the most part, unusable, really, just theoretical observations. So there's one that's actually based off of learning with errors. It's just a multivariate version of learning with errors. This appeared in PKC 2012. And the basic idea of this is you have a gigantic modulus and a large system of equations, and you separate out the equations into a quadratic component and a linear component. The linear component, you have the coefficients quite large. The quadratic component, you have the coefficients tiny. And you restrict your variables, the inputs, to be very small values as well. And what that does is it puts you fairly close to a lattice point defined by the lattice of the linear portion. But the quadratic thing, the weird thing is you have a weird distribution by this
collection of quadratic functions. So in order to get a proof to go through, you have to have gigantic, gigantic parameters to say that we're within so much of a measure of a Gaussian. So it's very awkward. So this actually is related to the question that was asked at the end of the last talk about why we don't use NP complete problems directly and derive our public key schemes from those. And I think in multivariate, we can maybe even generalize the question a little bit and say, can we use reduction theoretic proof of security for multivariate cryptography? And you have to think about what that requires, what that entails in general, just abstractly. You have to take some problem that's hard in some sense. It may not be NP complete or NP hard, but it's hard in some sense. You need to transform, you have to have an algorithm or show the existence of an algorithm which will transform that effectively into a public key for a scheme. And then if you can break that public key, then you can solve that problem. Well, in order to do this conversion into a public key for a scheme, you need to know it's legitimately a public key for your scheme that you're analyzing. And how do you do that? That's a big question. Like, how do you know that what you transformed it into is a public key for your scheme? So in some sense, you have to, that proof of the existence of this transformation has to somehow contain solutions in the multivariate case of decisional IP problems. So what I mean by that is you have to show that there exists a private key of this form for your scheme, which corresponds to a public key. There exists an algorithm that transfers you into that public key. So somehow you're doing something that's very difficult even in deriving this this transformation. So somehow inherently it's a difficult task in order to build something directly off of a hard problem of any sort, at least for multivariate. The situation is different in other contexts. So what can we do if it's the case that we can't do reduction theoretic proof, which I've given nothing formal about that, but if it's the case, what can we do? Well, we can try to learn from historical attacks. And what attacks have we had that have been successful in history? Well, we've had some algebraic attacks, like pure attacks on MQ, and that means somehow that the scheme was designed poorly. It gave you MQ instances which were actually easy to solve. So the first HFE challenge for the HFE system was one such example. It actually gave an instance of MQ which happened to be easy. Okay, so avoid easy MQ instances. We can do experimentation with toy examples of schemes, increasing the size to see how that complexity changes as we change the parameters. And we can make good guesses about that. We can do degree of regularity analysis to say, here is what we expect the complexity in general to be. And we can be fairly confident of those results in general. So we can analyze algebraic attacks. Rank attacks, well, if you design a scheme, you have access to the public key yourself. Do your rank analysis on your private key. Do your rank analysis on your private key. It's the one that has the particular properties that define your scheme. Do the rank analysis on there and see if you have any abnormal rank properties. If you have some, then maybe there's some potential for a rank attack to actually work in practice on the public key. So this is not, you know, it's not magic or something mysterious. It's something you can practically do. Just analyze the private key. Differential attacks, same sort of situation here, really. If you are a designer of a scheme, you have access to your private key. You can take differential of your private key. You can analyze it for different differential properties, whether it satisfies some kind of a general linear differential symmetry, whether it satisfies some kind of a differential invariant relation. Or alternatively, if you want to think about proofs of security against such attacks, you can prove that it has no non-trivial structure in terms of differential symmetry, in terms of differential invariance. Okay, the other side of the coin. This Q rank, this notion of rank over an algebra, a large algebra overlying your system. Same thing, you have access to your private key. Like think of the instance of HFE. You have access to your private key. You can express it over this giant algebra and you can look at the rank of your differential. Of your private map. Okay. So we can try to prove resistance to known attacks, and this does not make us very happy. We write smiley, unhappy face for that. But at least it is worth something. What it means, if we can actually take a system and prove its resistance to known types of attacks, is we can be assured that when it is broken, if it is broken, possibly when, that it will be something fundamentally new and we'll learn something new about it. So that's all also very valuable just for the theory. So how do we go about proving the resistance to these known attacks? For the algebraic attacks in general, you're going to do a degree of regularity analysis. If you can do a degree of regularity analysis and get a number which indicates that algebraically solving it with a Grobner basis solver is very complex, then that shows that algebraic attacks are just not going to work. Okay, this is a sort of probabilistic notion, but it's in practice, it's very, very accurate. For rank analysis, we can just perform that and see if there's any rank weakness. And we can eliminate possibility of rank weakness. For the differential, we can look at the symmetries, we can look at the invariants, we can do analysis on that. And it is often quite easy to just directly prove that there is no non-trivial structure here, that the only symmetries you have are symmetries that are derived from the fact that it's bilinear, that it's a bilinear map, the differential. Or invariants, the same thing. That you have, the only invariants you have are trivial invariants that are invariants for every function. So if you do that, then you can prove that there's no possible differential attack. For the Q rank, same thing, Q rank analysis. So let's go back and revisit the multiplicative symmetry, what broke the S-flash system. So again, the multiplicative symmetry, we symmetrically applied a multiplication to the two inputs of a differential, and we were able to factor out the effect of that multiplication. Okay, and that relation led to an attack, deriving these multiplication maps that allow you to extend to a full rank public key. So one question we could ask about this is, this special type of attack, since it applied to several schemes, I had more listed on the slide before, to what extent is it applicable? So you can ask the question, fix this particular type of relation, multiplicative symmetry, what functions have this? That shows what schemes can possibly be affected by this attack. So if you look at it that way, all you need to do is prove a simple, very easy classification theorem. If I have any function from a field to itself with a bilinear differential which has multiplicative symmetry, it must be exactly a map with one quadratic monomial summand. And this is very, very generalizable, the result. This is the very specific case where we have a big field situation, where we have an extension field over a finite field. But we can look at situations where we have algebras over that base field. And you can generalize this result to work in those cases as well. And so it proves that, for instance, anything that has the same flavor as the LIC minus scheme, it can only be attacked if it is LIC minus. That's what that proves. An immediate corollary to this is if I look at a projection, okay, my projection, I can think of it as being part of my core map, because I usually use the fact that U and T are invertible for actually practically inverting the scheme. So if I consider it to be part of the core map, then I can see that the only way that I can satisfy the multiplicative symmetric relation is if it's itself a monomial map. What does that mean? If your M is a projection, you no longer have the multiplicative symmetry. It breaks that symmetry. Okay, so we can turn that question on its head. We can turn that problem on its head. We fixed a type of relation, and we looked for types of functions that would satisfy that relation. That's saying, where is this attack applicable? We can ask the opposite, which is actually a much more profitable question to ask, and that is, if I fix a particular function, if I fix a core map F, what possible general linear symmetries can it satisfy? What are the possible relations that it could satisfy? Does it have to be multiplication? Can it be something else? And so if we generalize the definition of the multiplicative symmetry, we get this general linear symmetry definition that we stated before. And you can see here we're symmetrically applying a linear map L to the inputs, and we factored out the effect. Okay, that's a special relation. Okay, so the space of maps which satisfy this, we call SG, okay, it's just the space of maps. I have no idea why the G. I really don't know. I don't remember why I called it G. But if we can prove, in particular for this, that there are no non-trivial symmetries, That is to say that this space SG is just multiplication by scalars in your base field, for instance. Okay, if you're only multiplying by scalars in the base field, then you have no non-trivial symmetry to possibly exploit in an attack. You can't make a differential symmetric attack. Okay, and so we can actually do this in practice with some schemes. Here are basic properties that this space of symmetry has. It is a subspace of the space of linear maps. Okay, it's of course closed under scalar multiplication. This shows it's closed under addition. In characteristic two, we even have an additional property that it's closed under squaring. So if you take any even polynomial in a map in the symmetric space, that stays in the symmetric space. Okay, so if we have even one, this guarantees that we're going to have a lot of them in characteristic two. Okay, so if we look at, for example, just as a prototypical example, look at the C star cryptosystem, then we already knew that it satisfied the multiplicative symmetry. So we already know that the entire field K is already contained in that space of symmetries. Okay, so we know something about it. We can prove more than that, though. We have a theorem that if F is a C star monomial, then SG is exactly K in most cases. It's exactly K. And if not, it's actually a three-dimensional K algebra. That's the only other possibility, that it's a three-dimensional K algebra. So even worse, it's larger. So there are more maps that could possibly produce an attack. Okay, so basically C star is very, very bad. The idea of the proof, I'm not going to go through all the details of this just to save some time, but the idea of the proof is just to simply expand everything out in its linearized form, all of your linear maps, and get what the output is. So if I actually expand df of max and df of amx, I get these two summations here. If I expand the other side of that symmetric equation, the lambda mx, or lambda m should be df over here. Okay, see, lambda m df, then we get this quantity right here. And so because the monomials a to the q to the I, x to the q to the j are independent, they're linearly independent for all I and j, all I need to do is equate coefficients here, and I can solve for the coefficients of m, this one matrix m, and the coefficients of the matrix lambda m. Okay, and when we do that in this particular case, we get that all of the MIs are zero, so that matrix M, it's all zero except maybe just the M0 portion. Maybe the M0 is non-zero. And the fact that it satisfies this relation, we can actually derive that that M0 must actually lie in FQ. It has to lie in the base field, so it's a scalar. So that means that the only solutions to that linear differential equation, the only solutions are the linear maps which correspond to scalar multiplication, that you can factor out scalar multiplication. Well, you can always do that, right? It doesn't matter what your map F is. The differentials are bilinear. You can always factor out scalar multiplication. So there is no non-trivial structure other than these multiplications. Oh, I'm sorry. I'm thinking about a different case there. I was thinking about the projection that I'm going to do on the next slide. For the C star, this could actually be anything in K. For the C star minus, which we'll do on the next slide, that's the one where we get it, that it's just a scalar multiplication. Okay. So the one case here that was interesting is whenever we had these two sets intersecting. Okay. If these two sets intersect modulo n, then you can get this weird kind of wraparound effect, which allows other maps other than multiplications to be maps that induce symmetry. And so then in that particular case, you actually get a three-dimensional K algebra. Okay, so what I was talking about before, we can skip square. Yeah, what I was talking about before is this one. So what about the projected C star minus scheme? So what if we used a projection to make that U map non-invertible so that we couldn't get those multiplication maps in sigma? If that's the case, we're really looking for this symmetry over a subspace. So you can see here that I'm projecting the inputs of df. We're looking for a symmetry that exists over a subspace. So we're looking for maps M satisfying this relation for some lambda M. Okay, and it's quite technical, actually, and there are a lot of different parameters that you need to have in special places because as soon as you project, things just get a lot more complicated. There are a lot of different ways for different quantities to collide. But the end result of this theorem is that your only maps M that work are multiplications composed with that projection for some multiplication in the extension field K. And then whether it is non-trivial, whether it is a scalar multiplication or whether it's multiplication by a non-scalar that is an entity in the extension field, that's determined entirely by the map pi. So if your map pi, if, for example, the rank of it is coprime with the dimension of the system, then the multiplication that you recover that satisfies this, the sigma, it actually has to lie inside of the base field, so it has to be scalar multiplication. Okay, and if it's scalar multiplication, that's a trivial relation. Any function satisfies that trivial relation. Okay, so the proof of this is really fairly annoying. It's just a bunch of details. But you analyze the space of indices which make that lambda map have no contribution. That is, its coefficients are zero on the right side of that symmetric equation. And you can express that just in a graph here. And this shows you all of the monomials which give you no contribution on the lambda side. Then you can do the same thing for the other side of the equation, the side of the equation that corresponds to mapping M onto the differential. When you do that, you get actually four different bands like this, two in this direction and two that go up in this direction. And anywhere where they intersect, you are assured that the coefficient of the map M is zero in there because you have a non-zero coefficient inside of M, and it's exactly one coefficient, and it's equal to zero because the gray stuff is all zero on the right-hand side of the equation. So you're getting a bunch of zero coefficients for M, and if you trace through all the arithmetic and the bookkeeping, you actually get that the only possibility for M is that the smallest d coefficients are non-zero and that they're all equal. And in the statement of the theorem, that means that it's actually a multiple of pi. You take the pi map and you look at its image and then multiply by a scalar. Okay. Okay, so that's differential symmetry. And maybe in the last 10 minutes or so here, we can look at differential invariance. So the first and most basic notion of a differential invariant would be a simultaneous differential invariant. So a simultaneous differential invariant is a subspace which gets mapped into itself by any bilinear map in the span of the differential coordinate forms, considering them as linear maps. So an example of this would be, suppose I had this scheme. So I have this direct sum of two vector spaces, V and W, and my vector X comes from that. That's my ciphertext. Okay, and I'm just identifying two orthogonal subspaces which produce K. And now my map F is going to be the sum of two particular functions, G of Y and H of Z, where Y lives strictly in V and Z lives strictly in W, okay, where these are quadratic. If I look at the differential, it'll have exactly this form. I'll have the cross terms from the quadratic map G, I'll have the cross terms from the quadratic map H, but there are no cross terms between the two variables Y and Z. They don't interact quadratically in any way. Okay, so this, it's very clear that I have two giant invariant subspaces here. It's an invariant subspace corresponding to the lower component of a vector multiplied out here, and an invariant subspace that corresponds to the upper component of the vector up here. So this is true for every one of the differential coordinate forms, all of the DFI. So therefore, the V and W are simultaneous differential invariants of F. The span of the differential coordinate forms maps those spaces into themselves. Okay. So that's the simplest possible notion of a differential invariant. So then what about first order differential invariant? So a first order differential invariant, just to reiterate, that is a subspace V which maps entirely into a subspace W under the action of any map in the span of the differential coordinate forms. So in particular, this is the case with the simultaneous differential invariance because your W is actually equal to V. So that's just a special case of this, but this is more general. And a simple example of that would be the oil vinegar system. We actually used a differential invariant attack on the oil vinegar system earlier. Okay, so there's some simple properties of differential invariance. If I have a map F quadratic and I have L a non-singular linear map, if I have a first order differential invariant of F composed with L, then I have a first order differential invariant of F. Okay, and the proof is very short and easy, and I'm assuming that at some point you'll get access to these slides so you can look at the details of it, but it's completely trivial. Another trivial property of this is if you have a quadratic map F and a linear map L, if you have a first order differential invariant of F, which is called V, then the preimage of V is in fact a first order differential invariant of F composed with L. And this is true even if L is singular, in fact. So, but again, it's completely trivial to prove, not very interesting or enlightening. How do we actually try to access the information of a differential invariant in order to prove things about it, like maybe prove that they do not exist? The easiest way is actually to turn your invariant into a symmetry. Okay, it's not going to be a linear symmetry because it's something else. It's going to be essentially a quadratic symmetry, actually. But the way we do this is we look at, quote, orthogonal subspaces. Dot product is weird and positive characteristics, so you can have a vector that's orthogonal to itself, for example. But we mean orthogonal in the traditional type of sense that you would suspect. So let V be a subset of K, this extension field, or it could just be, it doesn't even have to be an extension field, it just can be a vector space over FQ. Define V perp to be the set of X such that the standard inner product is zero. That's supposed to have equal zero for all V and V. Okay, so from the existence of a differential invariant V, we can derive the existence of a particular nonlinear differential symmetry. And that is, there exist maps M perp and M, which when we apply those to both of the inputs of the differential, we get zero. And how do we know this exists? Well, M, think of it as a map that projects you onto V, your first order differential. And think of M perp as the map that maps you onto W perp. Okay, so the orthogonal space to where V gets mapped by the differential. Then if I write this out in matrix form, I would have any vector X, I map it by M, it goes into V. Then I would map it by DF, it would go into W. But then I'm taking the dot product of that with something that mapped by M perp goes into W perp, right? So I have the inner product of something in W and W perp, I get zero. Okay, so you can derive this non-linear differential symmetry directly from the differential invariant. So then to prove that something doesn't have any non-trivial differential invariant structure, it suffices to prove that it doesn't have any non-linear differential symmetry. You can just analyze it as an equation directly. So we can look at, just again, as a prototypical example, we can look at C star, just because it's easy to analyze, no other reason. Then this one, we can prove directly that it has no non-trivial first order differential invariant. Okay, and how can we go about proving this? We just, again, expand out this formula, see what it's equal to. And we know that for it to be a first order differential invariant, it means this quantity is equal to zero. But again, since this is C star, the domain is all possible values of A and X inside of my extension field, I know that the monomials A, Q to the I, X, Q to the J are linearly independent in the function space. And so that means that all of these coefficients have to actually simultaneously be zero. So we get this equation. This is equal to zero for all I and J. There's a little problem here. That should be an I. I think there's a little problem with this somewhere. There aren't both J there. I think this one's supposed to be an I. Anyway, you can derive it very easily. Okay, so take that relation, the relation that simultaneously we have all of these quantities equal to zero. Well, what do these look like? These things look like, in characteristic two, they look like a determinant of a 2x2 matrix. So we can just express the information that all of these are simultaneously zero compactly in matrix form. Okay, so just write out this matrix, and now you notice that every 2x2 minor, so let's take the first block here, this is exactly one of those equations. But the fact that this 2x2 minor is zero is exactly one of those equations. M0 times this quantity plus M0 perp times this quantity gives us exactly one of those equations from the previous slide. It's true for all of the minors here simultaneously, so this matrix has rank one. What does that tell us? That tells us that the first row times some quantity is equal to the second row. First column times some quantity is equal to the second column times different quantities for the different columns. Putting that information together, you can just do a little equation chasing and derive that a relationship between the M perps and the M's. And that relation specifically is that each M perp I is equal to just MI times some quantity SQ to the I. Okay, and if you look at the consequences of that, you see that in fact your M perp map is actually M, your M map, composed with multiplication by S, multiplication by some element S. And the only way this is possible is if that is in fact rank one and rank one over the base field FQ. So again, it's a scalar multiplication essentially, and every single quadratic map has that property. Every map would satisfy that nonlinear symmetry. So it doesn't give us any information about F over any other function. So no non-trivial differential structure. We can do the same thing for projected systems. We can look at PC star minus where we project it. And if we project it, the situation's a little bit more complicated because we have the kernel of the projection to deal with. But the same type of analysis actually tells you that you only have the kernel plus what you generate from scalar multiplication as your possibilities for differential invariance. Okay, these maps inducing differential invariance. And so there's no non-trivial differential structure for the projected system either. So again, that's an entire proof of security for the PC star minus scheme against differential attacks. Okay, now that doesn't say anything necessarily about rank attacks or something else. That's a different analysis. We would have to do that as well. So it's quite messy. It's quite messy. But that's the gist of it. The gist of it is you just have these tiny little theorems which are very, very easy to derive. There's nothing extremely hard about them because you have access to all the secret information. And you just see if these functions have these particular properties. If they fundamentally can't have them, you know there can't be an attack that exploits those properties because they don't exist. Okay, so that's a proof of security against those attacks. Okay, and that's about it. That's pretty much all I have. The point was to try to illustrate to you kind of the broad scope of MPKC. So that's the first component of the talk where we were talking about all the different disciplines that interact with MPKC in some way. Through the complexity theory stuff, through this really interesting connection to group isomorphism problems, through Grobner basis algorithms, and then structural attacks of different sorts, different flavors. Tell you and show you the tools for analysis, and I think most of the key results that have been progressive results in history, I think I've highlighted in here somewhere. And then some security results, at least, you know, kind of cheating and showing you my perspective and shamelessly presenting my work to you. But that's my interpretation of essentially what we can do now in terms of security. And so that's all I have. Any questions?